Oh, we worship you tonight, Jesus. Hallelujah. We worship your holy name, Lord God Almighty. You are worthy, Lord God, worthy, worthy, worthy of all the honor and glory and power and dominion and praise that we could ever give you, oh Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise your name this night, oh God. Hallelujah. Lord, we just invite your presence here tonight. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place tonight. We love you, Father. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we've come. We've gathered together in your name to lift up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Name above all others. Hallelujah. We glorify you. We magnify you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You alone are worthy, Lord. Worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, we praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. I will bless the Lord at all times. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. Hallelujah. Praises and glory and honor be unto Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, we praise you tonight, Lord. Have your way in our midst tonight, God. Have your way in our midst tonight, Lord God. We love you. May your word be declared tonight, Lord God, with power, boldness, and authority. We just praise your name and bless you. Hallelujah. We're going to keep on praising him and declaring his mighty works. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
You.
Hallelujah. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, we are free. We are free in Him. Hallelujah. We are free from the power and dominion of sin. Sin no longer has dominion over us. We've been made free. We've been made free from the old sin nature. We have a new life in us. We're new creatures. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Behold, old things are passed away. Old things passed away. All things have become new. Hallelujah. We're new creations in Him. Amen. Amen. Let's live like it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Oh, we love You, Lord. We thank You, Lord, for Your presence in this place tonight. We bless Your holy name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to Your name. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Oh, we love you, Lord. We just lift our hands unto you tonight, Lord Jesus. You're worthy. You're worthy, Lord. Worthy of praise, exaltation, adoration. Oh, we're so grateful, Lord. We're so thankful for our salvation. We're thankful, Lord, for this life that you have given us. Oh, Father, Lord, we love you. We worship you. We honor you. May your name, Jesus, be known in every corner of the earth, in every place, in every dark place. May it be lit up, Lord God, with your gospel. Oh, Lord, we love you. We worship you. Lord, we give you our hearts, our souls. Every part of us, Lord, belongs to you. We are your purchased possession, Lord. And we love you and praise you tonight, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah to your name. Hallelujah, Jesus.
You are my Lord. You are. Holy is our God. Holy is our God. Holy is our God. Holy, holy, holy. Holy are you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you.
Father, help us to understand that when we get more of you in our life, the love and the power will be there. Because you cannot be separated from your love and your power. Father, we love you. My belief is that we're here not out of religious exercise, but because we want to be here to be a part of what you're doing. Father, I thank you that Satan's grip, hold, and influence is broken over all those people that you know are supposed to be here in person and should be watching over the internet. I thank you, Father, that Satan is defeated in their lives, that the eyes of their understanding are enlightened, and the ones that are to be here physically, that, Father, they follow your leadership and they are here. And the ones that are supposed to be watching, they follow your leadership. They find the website. They log on. They watch. No matter where it would be in the world. Father, may your presence continually be strong in this place. And may we have a hunger in our hearts for more of you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, it looks to me like there are a lot of empty hands in this room. So why don't you find one and fill it with yours? Good to see all of you, and good to see all of you that I can't see. Thank you for being with us tonight. Hey, praise God, this coming Saturday, you ladies going to have a tea party. Ooh-wee. You can bring your paper dolls and just sit around and bring your nail polish and, you know, just paint each other's nails. And, well, you know.
You sound jealous.
You know how, I tell you what, I got to burst into tears up here. Ooh. Thank you. Then next Sunday will be a special celebration with Don Scott.
Amen.
We're going to be celebrating, you know, his 70th birthday. I mean, we don't have birthday parties for everybody, but this really is special. Nobody in his family history that they can find ever lived, you know, no man is at 70. So this is really a tremendous thing. Then plus, you know, he just had open heart surgery or bypass surgery here, you know, a few weeks ago. So this is going to be a real celebration time. He and Wanda are going to be bringing in some Kentucky Fried Chicken and some other stuff. Then there's a sign-up sheet back there for us to add to it. We won't have service on Sunday night. We're just going to take our time and eat and just enjoy each other's presence and, you know, I don't know, laugh at people, whatever. I don't know. Just have a good old time. And let's see here. Don't forget, you know, conference is coming up in about, what, 2 months? Is that right?
Yeah.
2 months? You see here, February, March, almost, you know, 2.5 months, whatever. Conference is coming up, I know that. Guess I better figure out when it is. You know, make sure I'm here, right? Yeah, I plan to be here, at least. You know, that was my original intention. So anyway, conference will be here, and been getting requests from people. You know, I've shared this with you before, that the people in other countries would understand the policies here that, you know, they have to have the money. We are not going to cover their expenses. And sometimes, man, that communication thing is, you know, would you please send an invitation letter to me and my associate pastor, my worship leader, whatever. Okay, well, you have to guarantee that you have the finances, that all of you have the finances necessary to make the trip. Dear pastor, thank you very much. I promise you I have the finances necessary. Okay, that's good. But the other people have to promise as well. You know, if you don't give me those guarantees, you don't get the letters. So, you know, sometimes the communication thing can be a real issue. Especially, I mean, they try their best. Honestly, they do. And their English is better than my whatever they speak. But sometimes they're not sure about the spelling of words. So I have to read and like, okay, now what does this word really mean? What's this word supposed to be? So, you know, I really want them to come over and be a part of this. But we want people to be here that are supposed to be here. And we want the people to understand that when they get here, don't be asking for help. Don't be asking for money. Just don't do it. So anywho, keep praying about the conference. Keep praying about the increase of finances here at the church. Remember, we want to see an absolute minimum extra $3,000 a week come in. That is not too much. You may think $3,000 a week is a mountain to God. It's pocket change. It's not even lunch money. It's just, what have I gotten down at the bottom of my pocket? Oh, an extra $3,000. There you go. It's not that big of a deal. We just have to continue to believe for God, believe for it to come in. And, you know, it's not a matter of God saying you guys aren't worth it. You know, Satan doesn't want it to happen. And then, you know, anyway, just for everybody to be obedient, they're giving, blah, blah, you know how it is. And all the people that are supposed to be here, there's a bunch of them out there. All righty, now that we know what we're supposed to do, let's move on to the sermon. This morning I began sharing the first part of a sermon entitled, The God of Restoration. We're going to pick this up tonight. I'm going to review a little bit from this morning to get a running start into how we're going to finish this the way the Lord wants it presented. In Joel chapter 1, before we get the reading, to kind of set the stage, we started in the book of Acts, where Peter, on the day of Pentecost, was talking about, you know, this move of the Holy Spirit, people speaking in tongues, and what you people are hearing and what we've experienced has nothing to do with drunkenness, has everything to do with the fact that this is what the prophet Joel prophesied when the Lord moved upon him. So we came back here to the book of Joel to begin reading this. And the Holy Spirit is using what we're reading in Joel to illustrate what's happening in the body of Christ. Now, this is for the a lot of people out there would say, well, I hear what you're saying about that, but you know, that's not the way I've always heard the book of Joel taught. I'm not arguing with you, not trying to create problems. I'm just saying this is how the Holy Spirit used these verses to illustrate what's going on in the church. So, in Joel chapter 1, verse 1, the word of the Lord came to Joel, the son of Pethuel. Hear ye this, ye old men, and give ear, all ye inhabitants of the land. Now, I shared with you that because he used this to illustrate what's happening in the church, we need to look at this phrase, inhabitants of the land, as a reference to the kingdom of God, or, you know, the body of Christ, or the church, the redeemed church. Hear this, ye old men, and give ear, all ye citizens of the kingdom. Hath this been in your days, or even in the days of your fathers? Tell ye your children of it. Let your children tell their children, and their children in another generation. In other words, you get the word out, make sure people know this. That which the palmer worm hath left, the locust hath eaten. And that which the locust hath left, hath the cankerworm eaten. That which the cankerworm hath left, the caterpillar hath eaten. So what we're seeing is a progression of events that has made things worse and worse and worse. The Holy Spirit was showing me how that this is a description of what's happening, or has happened, been happening in the body of Christ, how over time, progressively, things have gotten worse and worse and worse. Too many Christians want to look out at the world and say, man, things are getting bad out in the world. It's like, well, okay, but what about us? What about the church? Not us individually, per se, but in general, what about the church? Things have gotten progressively worse. The compromise, I've never seen anything like it in all my life. Well, he says, awake ye drunkards and weep and howl, all ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine, for it is cut off from your mouth. Again, the new wine symbolic of the new birth, the sum total of the born-again experience, the new life that we have in Christ. Another way to say it would be the completeness of the declaration of the gospel. And he said, awake ye drunkards and weep and howl, all ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine. Drinkers of wine, talking about corrupt doctrine. People who have become intoxicated on erroneous doctrine, and it's numbed their senses to the truth of the new wine. And he says, for a nation, where he says, where it's cut off from your mouth, the people are supposed to be declaring the truth. They're no longer declaring the truth. It's been cut off because of the drunkenness and the embracing of the old wine, the intoxicating doctrines of error. For a nation has come up upon my land, strong without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he hath the cheek of a great lion. Symbolically, you know, Satan is a roaring lion, seeks who he may devour, destroy, tear down. A nation has come up. This is not talking about, again, symbolism, not a specific country. It's talking about the rise, or the way he used it to illustrate, the rise of the godless in the nation, the heathen, if you will. How they are rising up, becoming stronger, and Satan is working through them to come against the body of Christ, to do everything he can to stop what we're trying to do. He hath laid my vine waste, barked or removed the bark of my fig tree. He hath made it clean bare and hath cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. Lament like a virgin. The body of Christ is the bride of Christ. Lament like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. Symbolically, the husband would be Jesus Christ. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests and the ministers mourn. The meat offering and the drink offering. Think in terms of the genuineness of real praise, not the motions of praise, but the genuineness of praise, the genuineness of teaching, the deep teaching, the meat of the word and so forth, if you will. He says, you know, it's been cut off from my house. It's not taking place in my church the way it's supposed to be. He says, verse 10, the field is wasted, the land mourneth, for the corn is wasted, the new wine is dried up, the oil languisheth. The corn representing the Word of God, the new wine representing the sum total of the gospel, the new birth, the born-again experience, and the oil, the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. He said, the field is wasted and the land mourneth, the body of Christ. How many times have we heard people in the kingdom of God, in churches, cry out, you know, where's the power, where's the reality, you know, where is, what? Where's the book of Acts, where is all of this? Well, the land is wasted, or the land mourneth. The land, meaning there are believers today, not all Christians have compromised, but there are believers today, those in the body of Christ, crying out, you know, where's the reality of what's supposed to be going on? Not simply a matter of the power, but the reality of who we are in Christ. Where is it, and where can we get it? Well, in chapter 2, verse 12, God has given to us in chapter 1 a diagnosis of the problem, a revelation of the problem. Now in chapter 2, verse 12, He begins giving to us the solution. He said, so you're mourning, are you? Those of you in my church, those of you in the kingdom, those of you in the body of Christ who, you still have some kind of desire to genuinely serve me, you're mourning. Well, let me tell you what it's going to take to get back to what it should be. Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning. Do not allow your heart to be distracted by other things. Rend your heart and not your garments. Don't put on the outward display of repentance and, oh God, I'm so sorry, but then it's not genuine. He says, no, forget about the outward works and appearance of genuine appearance. He says, you rend your heart. Turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious, merciful, slow to anger, of great kindness, repenteth him of the evil. In other words, he's saying, look, forget about how you've messed up. Forget about how you've had this cold relationship with him. You know, he's waiting for you now. He's slow to anger. He's merciful. You know, come boldly before the throne of grace. Who knoweth if he will return and repent and leave a blessing behind, even a meat offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God? Then in verse 15 he says, blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. And one of the things that I use this morning as an illustration, you watch the old Westerns, and, you know, when the armies are getting ready to, you know, go out and fight, you have a bugler, and the bugler sounds charge, but there's only one bugler. You don't have any more than one bugler. Bugler. Man. Bugler. Hornblower. There we go. You only have one hornblower. I think I'll have an easier time with that word. There's only one that does it. And the captain gives the instruction to the horn blower. He says, blow the horn for charge, right? All right, Jesus is the captain of our salvation. Now, we have an instruction here. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. There was only one bugler, one horn blower. So who is it that's supposed to be blowing the trumpet? Well, he tells us, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and those that suck the breast. Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber and the bride out of her closet. Let the priests and ministers of the Lord, verse 17. Now we're finding out who it is supposed to be blowing the trumpet. It's the people in charge, figuratively speaking, and really more so than anyone else, the pastors. See, whoever is in a place of authority in a church, that person can call himself an apostle if he wants to, call himself a pastor, call himself an evangelist, call himself a prophet, because a lot of people call themselves all kinds of things. They don't know what they really are. Regardless of the title that you give to the individual who has the primary responsibility of overseeing the congregation, that person is supposed to be the one to blow the trumpet in Zion. That person is supposed to make a declaration to the people. Gather together, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders or the leadership, the staff, whatever in the church, and the children, those that suck the breast, everybody, from babies on up. From babies on up. Now this is interesting because this tells me that even the babies are going to be impacted somehow by what takes place. A lot of times we think, well, you know, the babies, they really don't understand. I mean, they can't talk, they can't this, they can't that. And God is saying, even the little bitty babies that are still nursing, get them in here. That tells me that God is looking beyond what we see, and He's seeing little spirits. I mean, they're not born again, but He's seeing the innocence on the inside of them. Train up a child the way the child should go. God is saying, this is a part of that training. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, those that suck the breast, let the bridegroom, Jesus, go forth out of His chamber and the bride out of her closet. This is talking about Jesus, the church, joining together for a divine purpose. You know, oh Lord, we want to know Your presence. Well, He's saying, look, I'm telling you how that this kind of thing can happen. You do your part, I'll guarantee you the bridegroom is going to meet you. And He says, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar. Think of the symbolism here. The altar is the place where the priest ministers. Again, symbolically, I'm standing at an altar delivering the word of God. And it's like He's saying, before you get up and you start to do your priestly thing, here's what I want you to do. I want you to spend some time seeking after Me. I want you to spend some time praying and interceding on behalf of the people in your church. Spare thy people. Here's what I want you to do. Pray it like this, you know, this type of an intercession. Spare thy people, O Lord. Give not thine heritage to reproach that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? Meaning, pray for your people. Intercede that the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened, that they would realize what they're supposed to do. If there's a coldness in their heart, if there's a lukewarmness in their life, if there has been a searing of their conscience, whatever it be, intercede for them. Begin to pray for them that this is going to change. Now, He didn't say, change the people. He said, pray for the people. So, as a pastor, I can't change you. I can't, you know, I mean, it's totally up to the people to do their part. But He's saying, I want you to pray for them. I want you to intercede for them so that, here's the goal, so that the people come to the place in this solemn assembly, in this fasting, in this seeking of the Lord, in this gathering together to press into God for a change in you as an individual and as a congregation. You can't be responsible for everybody else, but you call the people together to seek for change. And He says, when this begins to happen and the change begins to take place, no longer are people going to look at you and say, oh, you know, well, okay, so you're a Christian. Well, that you're just like any of the rest of the Christians out there. I know how you Christians are. Well, no, you know how people are that say they're Christians. But remember what Jesus said, if you see Me, you've seen the Father. We're supposed to be at that place. If you see Me, you've seen Jesus. That's the way it's supposed to be. And guys, you and I both know it is not like that. In the body, it might be in your life, but it's in general, it's not like that among Christians. And yet we're all supposed to be at that place. Pastors or those who are what you would call lay Christians who don't, you know their ministry calling or whatever it would be. I mean, the whole body of Christ. And He says, now listen, if you do, verses 12 through 17, here's what's going to happen. Verse 18. Then will the Lord be jealous for His land, His people, His church, His kingdom, His, you know, body, His children, and pity His people. His heart will go out to them. You know, you've called a solemn assembly. You have come before Me with weeping and mourning. You've come before Me with all your heart. You've rended your heart and not your garment. You're serious about this. You're touching My heart with your passion for Me. And He says, the Lord will be jealous for His land and pity His people. Yea, the Lord will answer. Answer what? Answer what? What we're doing, 12 through 17, seeking Him, praying, seeking His face. He says, you do 12 through 17, and God is going to turn right around. You're going to touch His heart. He is going to respond. He is going to answer and say, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil. What was it that had been devastated earlier? The corn, the wine, and the oil. He's saying, listen, if you're serious, the way that you're showing Me that you're serious, verses 12 through 17, and I see your heart, and your heart means more to me than your actions, then you know what? I'm going to respond, and you're going to see, and I'm going to use this word revival, you're going to see in your midst a revival of my word, of the truth about who you are in Christ, and the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit. You're going to see these things restored. You want to know where the book of Acts is? It's like God is saying, I will give you the book of Acts. It's going to happen in your midst to the people that seek after me. And he continues and says, and you shall be satisfied therewith, and I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. How are we going to be satisfied? He's saying you're going to get to this place to where you're going to know that I am there with you and you are in my presence. You're no longer going to have the emptiness on the inside. Look, we all go through times of everything's great, everything's fine, and God's my best buddy and he's right here next to me. Well, then a few days later, it's like, I just don't feel God anymore. I just don't feel God. You're going to get to the place, what he's describing here is, you're going to be satisfied. You're going to be satisfied with the spiritual work that is taking place, and you're not going to continue to depend upon what you feel. And if you don't feel that I'm there with you, that is not going to be a concern. You're not going to think that I have abandoned you. You're going to know that your feelings do not have the final say about your relationship with me. He says, you are going to be satisfied, and you will no longer be a reproach among the heathen, meaning your life will be your testimony more than your words. What do I mean by your life? Hey, there are a lot of Christians. Yeah, a lot of people don't even know that somebody's a Christian until they open their mouth and say, hey, you know Jesus? But they don't even see a difference in the person's lifestyle. He's saying this restoration, this revival of corn, wine, and oil, it's going to produce in you a change. And this inner change is going to begin producing an outer change. Your life will be something that people will notice. There's a difference about you. Just when I get around you, I sense there is a difference about you. I'm so steeped in my sin, I don't want to be around you because you make me uncomfortable. So therefore, you know, I'm better off if you go away. No, you're better off if I stick around and irritate you. Because you need me to irritate you, because it's the holiness of God's life in me, you know, coming out of my pores and impacting you, touching your life. You need to feel this so that when you go home at night, it lingers with you. And hopefully, eventually, you're going to call out to God and say, I can't take this anymore. I want to be saved. And then he says in verse 20, but I will remove far off from you the northern army and will drive him into a land barren and desolate with his face toward the east sea and his hinder part toward the utmost sea. And his stink shall come up. You know, God, tell us what you're really going to do. And his stink shall come up. And his ill savor shall come up because he hath done great things. Now, there's a lot that this could mean, and I have no idea what the seas are and so forth. Let me tell you what the Holy Spirit was using this to illustrate. He was saying, you do verses 12 through 17, you're going to see me begin to move in your life, verses 18 through 20, or verses 18 and 19. And he says, verse 20 represents that the power of my life in you, just your existence, is going to begin to bring to light the filthiness of sin in this nation, in this world, in your community. Remember what happened with Jesus more than once. He's just going about his business. He is not bugging anybody. He gets in a boat and goes across, gets out of the boat, and he's on land. All of a sudden, a guy shows up. Jesus, what are you doing here? He's standing in a church just delivering the word of God. Somebody stands up. What are you doing here? We know who you are, that kind of thing. Okay, he's telling us in this, if you do your part, my life, my anointing, my presence, my strength, my glory, all of this is going to be on you. It's not going to be based upon your sense feeling. It's going to be based upon your spiritual reality. Who you really, listen, you honestly think Jesus ran around every day saying, "Whoo, I feel God. I feel God in this place. Whoo, I feel God. Oh, come on, people now. Let's go. I'm feeling God in this place today." No. You think Jesus ran around and said, "Fellas, y'all better just take a couple days off because I don't feel nothing today." I don't. But isn't that the way a lot of Christians are?
Yeah.
Jesus didn't go by his feelings. He went by who he was.
Amen.
His confidence in knowing I and the Father are one. God's talking about you'll come to that place. You're going to know that you, me, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, we're one. We are united, and you're not going to go by your feelings. When that begins to happen, that anointing in you is going to begin to expose the stink of sin in this nation. It's going to begin to expose the ill savor. Now that's a little, more polite than stink. But it's going to begin to bring these things to light. One of the things that will bring persecution to the body of Christ? Now I want you to think with me. Why in the world should a godless society persecute a backslidden Christian church? Why? Why persecute them? There's nothing to persecute. Do you understand what I'm saying? You do verses 12 through 17. You start seeing verses 18 and 19 come to pass in your life, and the glory of God begins to live through you. Now you're going to be persecuted. Because those who still have that sin nature, and really, to a certain extent, even some Christians who have so seared their conscience, they're going to come against you. Because they don't want you to stand up and say, "Hey, this is sin. Hey, this is wrong. Hey, this..." But God is saying, these things are going to be revealed more and more and more. Now here's one of the reasons why it's going to happen that way. So that when Jesus comes back, people are going to know, "Well, yeah, you were showing us that. Well, yeah, I do recall. Now that I'm standing before you in judgment, yeah, I remember. We persecuted those Christians. I remember we did this and we did that. I remember feeling something different about them, the ones that we shut down." You understand what I'm talking about, the imagery here? He's saying, look, see, light and darkness have no fellowship. You understand that light always overpowers darkness. You start experiencing what God is describing here, and the life, the glory, the anointing, and so forth of God in your life is going to begin to overpower the darkness in the lives of other people. And what's going to be their response? To lash back. That's exactly what happened with Jesus, to lash back. That's how you bring persecution on. And he continues and says, verse 21, "Fear not, O kingdom, O church, O body of Christ. Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things." God's telling you right here, I will move in your midst. You're going to see me move. Don't worry about what happens in verse 20. Don't worry about what's happened in the past. You do verses 12 through 17, and I, the Lord, am going to do great things. He says, "Be not afraid," verse 22, "ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring, for the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength." I mean, the sum total here is, I know it says, beasts of the field and so forth, but the Holy Spirit was showing me, verse 22, this is a revelation of restoration within the body of Christ. I mean, there's so much symbolism in this. I know it's natural stuff, but he says, in the broad scope of things, you're going to see restoration. You're going to see restoration in a move of God. It doesn't mean that your church is going to be packed out with, 10,000 people. He's just saying there's going to be restoration for the people who do verses 12 through 17. He says, verse 23, "Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain, in the first month. Now, this former rain and latter, a lot of people have talked about, you know, the former rain, the latter rain, and now both are going to come together. And some of the sermons have been really good, and some, you know, well, okay, you know, they were sermons, praise God. But notice what happens when this rain, think of it in terms of, okay, remember what Jesus said, out of your bellies shall flow rivers of living water. And there's a description of the river of life in heaven. Now, out of our bellies will flow rivers of living water. Where does that originate? Well, it originates with God, the rivers of living water. In other words, it's like it flows from Him spiritually through us. Out of my belly, out of, not within, out of. What does that mean? That means, first off, I've got to be, let me use descriptive terms, I've got to be at flood stage in me so that it can begin to flow. Not drip, not trickle, you know, not leaky faucet. No, flow, flow. And not just in the church services. He's talking about day-to-day life. No matter what you feel like, you wake up in the morning, your hair's going all, I mean, 360 degrees, your hair look just all over the place. And your breath, it's disgusting. We don't even want to talk about what your breath smells like. And you know you need a shower. I mean, you're gross, absolutely gross. But that's not what it's going to be about. It's going to be about what is in you, what is alive in you, who's working in you to will and to do of His good pleasure. See, 12 through 17 enable God to work in us to will and to do of His good pleasure. And he says, be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain. He will cause to come down for you the latter rain in the first month. There is going to be an increase of the flow of the rivers of life, the anointing. It's going to hit us. It's going to begin to flow through us. But remember, you have to do 12 through 17 first. There are a lot of people who have taught there's going to be the former rain and the latter rain is going to outpour. The church is going to feel it. There's going to be renewal. There's going to be restoration. And by people get to hollering and yelling, amen, amen, amen. But God says, no, you got to do verses 12 through 17 first, or there ain't going to be no former and latter rain in you and in your church. You have to do your part first, because my recollection of former and latter-day rain sermons, I don't remember them telling us, you got to do verses 12 through 17. Now, maybe they did, and I just don't remember it. But I don't remember an emphasis on it. I just remember, it's going to pour. It's beginning to rain. And people would, you know, just all excited about this. And God is saying, yeah, it's great that you're excited, but you better do verses 12 through 17 first. But now, look what's going to happen as a result of this anointing. And the floors shall be full of wheat, and the vats shall overflow with wine and oil. In other words, there is going to be this revival of doctrine, revival of anointing, revival of truth, revival of the fullness of our understanding of what salvation is all about. We're not going to, we'll get to the place to where, you know, we're not going to wake up and wonder about, you know, I just don't feel too righteous today. We're going to wake up in the morning, so we're going to know, I am the righteousness of God. I am created in righteousness and true holiness. We're going to come to this place of fully understanding and comprehend, like the Apostle Paul did, like what the Apostle Paul wrote to try to get the body of Christ to the place of understanding these things. He says, the floors are going to be full. The vats are going to be overflowing. In other words, he's describing what takes place in the church before there is revival in the community. Do you see this? It's got to start here first. And he says, now look at this. He says, I will, verse 25, I'll restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. He says, I'll restore. I'll restore what? Everything that was destroyed, I'm going to restore it. I'm going to restore it. All the years of the desolation, he says, I'm going to restore it. Now we sit back and we begin to think, how can he do that? That's because he's God. And he can look at what's happening here. Let's think of it like this. Just for the sake of illustration, use this church. I know at one time, from the things I've heard, old papers that I've read, from like 25, 30 years ago that I find in a nook or find in a cranny or stuffed in a box someplace. At one time, this place was nearly full. There were people all over the place. Classroom. I've seen pictures of the classrooms full of people. There's all kinds of praise, a praise band and all this other kind of stuff. And what happened, the time came, Satan found an opening and took advantage of it. And like Jesus talked, well, like it says in Scripture, the sheep were scattered. What you see in this place numerically of people, what you see in this place, it's a shell of what it used to be. Now, I'm not saying that everything that happened in the past was 100% truth that was taught. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is there were people here that really were seeking after God. That wasn't a question. There were people here who really wanted to see a move of God. There were people here that were full of the Holy Ghost. There were people here who did pray in tongues. There were people here that were trying, that were really trying. And some maybe were along for the ride. But Satan saw a threat, and he attacked. Now, if you were Satan, and you were looking at this, I mean, just if you peek through the window tonight, would you not think, I've been doing a good job? Would you not think, yeah, I shut this thing down? Truth is, he hasn't. He hasn't shut it down. In fact, there are probably more people being reached by this ministry right now than ever in the history of who congregated in this building. That's pretty amazing when you take a look and say, well, where are they? They're all over the place. But he says, I'll restore to you the years. Not just, I'll help you find your car keys. He says, I'm going to restore to you the years. We've been here for, my first Sunday here was February 21st, 1999. It's been a lot of years go by. He says, I'll restore unto you the years. Now I'm going to pause right here for a moment and point something out that the Holy Spirit pointed out to me. Even if a church congregation does not do this, an individual can. Even if you go to a church, it's like, well, you know, we're doing fine with our hymnals. Nothing wrong with hymnals. We're doing fine, you know, with our programs and our this and our that and the other and et cetera and so forth. In other words, I'm describing a church that's really kind of going through the motions. Not denying the salvation through Jesus, but kind of going through the motions. If you as an individual do verses 12 through 17, God will still move in your life in the same way. He wants it to happen within the congregation. Call your own personal solemn assembly. I mean, if the pastor's not going to do it, the church isn't going to do it, so on and so forth, then you know what? You can do it yourself. And this where he says, I'll restore unto you the years. I hope what I'm getting ready to share with you sinks in, because there are a lot of people need to hear this. There are people even possibly in this room tonight, but definitely some who have graced these seats. You feel like it's too late. You feel like, oh, if only I'd known all this 40 years ago, 30 years ago. Boy, if only, if only, if only. And you start looking back at the years you feel like you wasted. And God is saying, hold on here. Just hold on. I am God, and I am not bound by your calendar. Oh, I know your calendar, and I can see the second hand on your clocks, tick, tick, tick. I know that. I see it. I understand where you live, because in my Son, I lived where you're living. But I exist outside of those boundaries. And if I tell you that I can restore the years that you wasted, then you better believe I can restore the years you wasted. If I tell you that I can restore, you know, you think you wasted your life. You know, boy, if only I'd have served Jesus like this when I was a young kid. Hey, have you forgot who you're talking to? I'm God. I know the beginning from the end. I knew you were going to do this. I knew you were going to mess up. I knew you were going to backslide. I knew you were going to, and that's where he stops because he doesn't want everybody to know what we did. He says, I knew. I know. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He says, I knew all this stuff was going to happen. However, I knew it from before the foundation of the world. I have a plan of restoration for you. I have a plan of restoration for your church. I have a plan for restoration. And when I say that I can restore to you, now he could have said, I'll restore to you what the locust, cankerworm, caterpillar, palmer worm have destroyed. He could have said that, but he didn't. He said, I will restore to you the years. The years. Bless God, I don't know how he's going to do that. I look back over my life as a bunch of wasted years. I don't know how he's going to do that. Some of you, you've got more wasted years than what I have. He says, I will restore to you the years. The years. God, what's that mean? It's almost, don't worry about it. Just let me do it. I'll restore to you the years. The years. So maybe you wasted 5. Maybe you wasted 10. Maybe you wasted 30. God says, like that matters to me. I'm God. I will restore to you the years. Amen. You're not too old for this. What if you're 75 years old and you get this revelation? What are you going to do? Sit back and say, well, I just wish it was true for me, but I'm 75. And God said, hold on, I knew you were going to be 75 when you got this revelation. And I said, I will restore to you the years. I'm not going to roll the clock back and turn you into 25 again. All right, that ain't going to happen. But I will restore to you the years. It's a spiritual work. I'll restore to you the years. All you have to do is verses 12 through 17, and I begin this work, and you're going to start seeing the restoration. You're going to see it happen. If you feel like, whether you're here, whether you're watching, if you feel like it's too late, if you feel like I can't, if you feel like, well, I've not done enough, well, I this and I that, not, because a lot of us have gone through that. Some of us may be going through it right now. God is promising you right now. This is a promise from Almighty God. And he says, I will restore the years. Think of it like this. All the stuff that you I'm going to have to use human terms because I don't know the full function of all this. But all the what could have beens, God knows what they are. And he's got them over here in a storehouse with your name on it. And the moment you do 12 through 17, he goes over and he opens that storehouse and he starts restoring what could have been. He starts restoring what you missed. He starts restoring whatever needs to be restored. He starts restoring. Now, this is God saying this. Don't try to analyze it. Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to, well, God, I'll believe it when I see it. No, he says he'll restore. Come on, man. He says he'll restore the years. Now, look in verse 26. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God that hath dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. You'll eat in plenty. There's another symbolism in this. In other words, spiritually, you're going to realize you have everything you need in me. Don't take verse 26 as a promise you're going to be a millionaire. All right? Don't do it. But he says you'll eat in plenty, be satisfied. What would be the primary focus? My spiritual eating. You understand that? And he says, and you know what? You feel like you've lost your praise? There are a lot of Christians that feel like they've lost their praise. He says, it's going to be restored. You're going to praise me, not out of religious form and exercise. You're going to praise me out of what I'm doing in you as a result of what you did in verses 12 through 17. You will begin praising me from your heart. And you shall know, you shall be utterly convinced with no questions, doubts whatsoever in your mind that I am in the midst of you, your home, your church, your life, your everything, that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. Never be, in other words, The whole concept is you're going to be living with a confidence of the reality of who God is and who you are in Him, and you're not going to feel like, well, I'm missing out because I don't have this and I don't have that. He goes, no, your confidence will be in me. Your hope will be in me. Your everything will be in me. You're going to know. You're not going to just sit around and say, boy, I wish I knew, or I sure wish this, and someday maybe. No, He says, you will know that I am your God. You will know. This is telling me that we're going to come to the place of having an inner spiritual revelation, inner eye-opening experience, to the place to where we're going to have a confidence in our relationship with God that I'll go so far as to say not one of us in here presently has. Amen. That it's going to go deeper than anything we have ever known. It will be the way it was with Jesus. He knew who He was. He knew what He could do because of who He was and who His Father was. Everything else was secondary to Him. And He continues and He says, now look at this, and it shall come to pass afterward, after what? Now let's keep the symbolism. After you do, verses 12 through 17, opening the door of your lives, your church, to me, so that I can do the verses 18 through 27 work in you. It will come to pass after that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. Where's it going to be poured from? Us. It's not going to be this random, you know, just, well, God's going to move someplace. No. Now, again, remember, we're talking symbolism. We're talking about revival here. We're talking about getting to the place to where God can move through us to bring about revival. I'm not talking about the kind of revival where, you know, all the news broadcasts are there. That is irrelevant. It doesn't matter if the cameras show up or not. What matters is people coming to Jesus Christ. That's what matters. Because you're not going to have news cameras in the middle of a jungle someplace when you're having all the tribes in the rainforest come to Jesus Christ. Who's going to know about that? It doesn't matter who in the world knows about it. What matters is that God sees what's happening and His Spirit is flowing through us like it flowed through Jesus, like it flowed through the apostles. His Spirit is going to flow through us. He says, I'll pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. Your sons, your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams and your young men shall see visions. You've done verses 12 through 17. I've done my work, verses 18 through 27. And now I'm going to use all of you, not just the guy behind the pulpit. I'll use the secretary who puts in 50 hours a week for the attorney, but I'm going to use her. I'm going to use the guy who digs ditches. I'm going to use the dentist. I'm going to use everybody who does verses 12 through 17. I will use my church, my children, my kingdom, and bring these things to pass. He says, you're the sum total of my children, verse 28, are going to do these things. Upon the servants and the handmaidens in those days, I'll pour out my Spirit. I'll show wonders in the heavens and the earth, blood and fire, pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon into blood, before the great and terrible day of the Lord. In other words, before the final day, before that moment when Jesus comes back and it's all over. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered, saved, rescued, redeemed. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. He's talking about there are people out there right now, their hearts are tender, they just need to hear the message. They just need to have a touch by the power of the Holy Spirit. And He's saying, you want to see revival? I'm telling you how to see it. It's going to start with you, and then I, through you, will move, and I will pour my Spirit out through you and touch people, and they are going to call upon the name of the Lord, and folks are going to be swept into the kingdom. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I want to see this. I want to see this. Now, here's the thing, guys. You've heard this morning. You've heard tonight. And I would say that this is one of those messages that anybody who has any kind of affiliation with this ministry, they need to hear these. Because in the days to come, number one, I've got to up my prayer on behalf of the congregation. And I've got to seek God concerning this whole thing about calling the solemn assembly. In other words, calling these times for us. Not just the fasting, that'll be a part of it. And again, we'll talk about the fasting thing later. But see, what it comes down to is this. Do we want what will happen starting in verse 18 and going forward? Do we want it? It's not about we're going to see hundreds come into this church and join. I mean, we don't even have official membership anyway, but you understand what I mean. It's not what it's about. It is about the lost and the backslidden. That's what it's about. See, just because somebody's not filled with the Holy Ghost and speaks in tongues doesn't mean they're backslidden. It just means they haven't had that experience. But man, they may be on fire for Jesus. It's about the lost and the backslidden. I want to see this. But I'm going to have to examine myself. Because, guys, this takes commitment. I mean, we have to be ready to just lay stuff aside. And we can talk about television. We can talk about, we can talk about everything. You know, your life, my life, the stuff in our life. We're going to have to get our priorities in order. And I'm telling you guys, it's not easy. It's just not easy. Because like I said this morning, the more you press into God is the more your flesh takes on the persona of an armed warrior ready to do battle. We don't know how tough our flesh is until we start trying to press into God. And it's not simply about fasting. How many times have you said, I'm going to increase my prayer time? And the flesh pulls out a club and just beats on you for a while. You forget about what you said, right? I'm going to increase my Bible reading. And the flesh says, yeah, sure you are. Sure you are. Whap, whap, whap. See, really, we want to blame the devil for a lot of this stuff? It's the unmortified flesh, guys, sometimes more than the devil. This is going to take hard work on our part. And a lot of people can twist this and turn it into, so he says you can't do this, you can't have fun, you can't watch football anymore. Don't even play those games with me. That is not what I'm saying, and that's not what God's saying. Although he might say things like that to some people, you know, depending upon how far off track we are. Turn that TV off. What? I spent, you know, God, do you know how much I spent? Yes, I know how much you spent for that TV. I was there. Remember that funny feeling you had on the inside? That was conviction not to buy, but you did it anyway. So yes, I know. Turn it off and leave it. It'll still be there. It'll just for now, turn it off. But God, I want to see how it ended. Well, you got DVR, record it. Watch it later. You know, DVR is probably one of the greatest benefits to God because now he can say, just record it and watch it later. Right now, I want you to pray. He's been up there for centuries waiting, hurry up and invent DVR. But this is going to take some effort on our part. And it's not going to be legalism. Call it. Blow the trumpet. Call the people together. And the people who are serious, guess what? They'll show up. They'll show up. Praise God. Well, I don't know about you, but for me, I get excited when the Holy Spirit does things like this, shows these things to me. So anyway, praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Everybody go ahead and stand. Bless your name, Lord. Bless you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I worship you. I love you. Thank you for showing this to us, Father. That, Father, there is hope. Hallelujah. So I ask you to help us. Give us wisdom. Give me wisdom. We want to have those solemn assemblies, those things that we're supposed to do. We don't want to do it, Father, just because we read something in the Bible and it's now, well, we got to do it. Father, we want to do what you want us to do. We want to have the right balance in what you want us to do. So guide us, lead us, direct us in this. We want to see the end results that you've promised. And we want to see that restoration of the years. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you so much for the people who are a part of this ministry. We are a blessed congregation. We are a good church. And I thank you for it. And I thank you, Father. Father, I just want to thank you right now for the 34 years that I've had with Kathy. I thank you, Father, that she's my wife, and for the helpmeet that she is, and for, Father, the way that she's a strength, an encourager, and the way that she is a pillar here in this ministry. Thank you for the way that you use her to touch other people's lives. Thank you, Father, for her being such a blessing to me. And Father, I thank you for all the people who are part of this ministry. As a pastor, I am truly, truly blessed. And Father, tonight as we leave, just ask you to watch over us, protect us and our vehicles, and may your presence be strong in our homes. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, folks, listen. If you have an offering tonight, please bring it up. Continue to pray about an increase in the finances coming in, increase in the people coming in. We want to see everything that God desires take place. Need me to pray with you about anything? I'll do so before you leave. But other than that, have a blessed evening, and we'll see you later on.